What's up, ladies and gentlemen? Daily here from Nation Fusion, and today I have a review for you for Rising Storm 2 Vietnam. Rising Storm 2 Vietnam is the next installment in the Rising Storm series from our friends over at Tripwire Interactive and Antimatter Games, and this one is, I don't want to classify it like officially because this is really just kind of my opinion, to me this is like a standalone expansion pack. It doesn't necessarily encompass a bunch of new features and a bunch of new ideas and things like that. It is more an expanded and new take on some of the Rising Storm and Red Orchestra 2 things that we've already seen in the past here. So, what is it? Is it good? And is it worth your money? So, Rising Storm 2 Vietnam is definitely, it's a good game. It's fun to play. It's got a dynamic about it, obviously being set in the Vietnam War. They have a interesting way to kind of bring this war to you in their own style. If you've ever played Red Orchestra 2 or the Rising Storm expansion pack, Rising Storm 2 Vietnam capitalizes on that with great visuals, very fun gameplay, and it actually does add a couple of new things to the Rising Storm franchise, which you haven't really seen before, but this in no way is like a brand new Rising Storm. It's not built from the ground up, so a lot of the glaring flaws that were in some of the previous titles are still here today. So, let's talk about basically what you're getting into here. So, Rising Storm 2 Vietnam puts you in the place of two factions on each side. So you'll have the United States Army and the United States Marine Corps, and then you'll face the North Vietnamese Army as well as the I'm gonna forget the name of them, the one in the black pajamas, whoever those guys are. So basically you've got two different sides to the gameplay here, and each kind of have some of their own unique characteristics as far as like what kind of abilities they can use, such as anti-air on the Vietnamese side. They have different anti-air weapons, they have different types of barrages, and the Americans have the same thing. But what's a little bit different here, and what's actually kind of exciting and what was extremely fun for me to see, is you can actually fly helicopters in this game if you're on the American side. Now, the North Vietnamese don't have any helicopters open to them, so you're not going to get to fly from each of the like the different sides or whatever. They don't have their own respective helicopters. Only the Americans do, and they have a couple of different variants, which I was excited to see. And at the same time, I was a little nervous. Vehicles in Rising Storm Red Orchestra have never been like great pieces of machinery. They've been interesting additions to the gameplay, but here in Rising Storm 2 Vietnam, they feel good. They're fun to fly. They have different purposes, and they have a very, very interesting like damage model where they can stay up and be very hard to control and sustain like small amounts of damage before having to go back. No longer are you like hitting like a damage cap and then exploding out of nowhere. You'll take, you know, equipment failure and rotor blade failure. And I even had a clip here where they actually shot off my back tail section and the cabin was still intact, spinning in the air at an incredibly high speed. So there are a lot of interesting and fun things to do here. There are a wide range of weapons. However, this is where things kind of start to go down, is just in quantity. In terms of weapons, there are a few variants of a few different types of weapons, but really you're stuck to a couple main ones, and they do have some interesting mechanics with them, like the machine guns can overheat and the barrels can warp, but we've seen that before. Here it's just a little more prone to happen because this particular war included a lot of automatic rifles and a lot of light machine guns, so you're going to see that being utilized throughout the different maps. And while there's not a significant selection of weapons, the ones that are here are fun. That was one of my first complaints, is I felt like the game needed a little bit more equipment. When you're playing as an American, you're limited to like two grenades and a rifle as a grunt man or whatever, but beyond that, everybody pretty much has the same kit, so you're not finding like a lot of different weapon variations. There's like an M14 in there as well, and the M16 A1 in its automatic rifle form. So, I mean, you do have a few variants, as I said, but I felt like it could use more. The other side, the Vietnamese side, they have quite a few more variants of some of their weapons, and they have like traps that they can put down, mines and all that kind of stuff. So I would have liked a little bit more on the equipment and weapon side of things. Not that, like I said, there's not enough in there to keep it fun. It's just after you play, you know, the grunt, which is normally what you're going to play as, there's only a certain amount of slots per server. So there's like two snipers, two sappers, two machine gunners, and that's for the entire server. So if you're not one of the first ones in there, you're going to be stuck in the grunt kit. And if you don't have, you know, a bunch of weapons and things to play with, it can get boring pretty quickly, especially the way some of the rifles behave. It's going to take you a long time to figure out which one is kind of your favorite and what you're going to do there. But the same can be said for the North Vietnamese side. After a while, you know, one AK variant is very similar to the other AK variants. It's really just a preference on... you know, what kind of optic or what kind of sight you're going to be using. But I did enjoy the shooting mechanics. They're a lot of fun. You know, getting headshots is very, very satisfying. And with a lack of weapons, the gameplay has to make up for it. All right, moving on. Another thing I felt had a very large lack of, and that was maps. There's only a couple of maps in the game for a couple of different game types. And I feel like in a game like this, where it's very limited due to the time period and the war that they're trying to portray, you have to have a plethora of interesting maps. And here the maps are interesting. Hue City is a great map. The one you're seeing in the background now, I forget the name of it because I'm not... some of the names are very similar, and I haven't been like researching the maps too much because there's only a few of them, you know. So I don't want to spoil everything inside of the map. I want to, you know, get my full play experience out of them. But the ones that are in here, they are fun to play. They do offer some like tunnels that go throughout the map. If you are the Vietnamese, which was interesting, you can use a squad tunnel, which is something that a squad leader can put down for the Vietnamese. If you're on the other side, you can spawn on your squad leader if you're an American, which I felt was a little cheap. I really hate spawning on a particular person. I would have preferred more usage of maybe like the Huey helicopter, which is one of the helicopters in the game, as well as the Cobra and the Little Bird. So there's, as I mentioned before, there's a couple of different helicopters and a couple of different roles for them. And I felt like the Huey could have been maximized if they designed a few more maps with that in mind, instead of just randomly appearing on your squad leader. It can lead to some really game-breaking situations. On both sides, it can lead to you spawning on the squad leader and instantly dying, or if you were on the Vietnamese side, you can be holding a position against one guy, and that one guy might happen to be a squad leader, and then four guys might spawn on him, and you might get fucked. So, I mean, I personally don't like that. I did like the tunnel system, though. I felt like spawning in the tunnels was very interesting. It made me think, as a squad leader, where is the best place to deploy this. You can't put it too close to objectives because enemies can see it, as well as there's like a barrier, like a soft barrier of like 20 meters from an objective or something like that. So I did end up having a lot of fun and interesting gameplay trying to find a good spot for my squad tunnel for my people to spawn on. Now, overall, the game is a lot of fun. It does, like I said, have a few lacking parts. I did hate the weapon sounds in this game, which is it's a lot to say for me because normally I love the way that Red Orchestra portrays their weapons and things like that. I played a lot of the original Red Orchestra, played the sequel and Rising Storm as well, and now moving here, I like the distance sounds. Like, the explosions are great, the combat from a distance is amazing, but the first person sounds that you hear shooting like an AK-47 or an M16, they just sound a little weak and a little dull. So hopefully that's something that can maybe be addressed in the future with the addition of more weapons, because right now it sounds very repetitive and very annoying to shoot some of the basic weapons. But let's just get the overall picture here. So we have a game set in Vietnam with flyable vehicles. We have 64-man combat. We have flamethrowers, machine guns, all sorts of different avenues of approach, and a couple of great made maps. Yes, I wish there was a little more here, but overall, Rising Storm 2 is a good game. It is a lot of fun to play. I put a lot of hours into this game already, and I can't wait to put some more in there. I gotta commend the guys over at Tripwire and Antimatter Games. They made a really good product here. But please, never stop trying to improve. There's a lot of room for improvement in this game. It can get very clunky, and I see a lot of people on that borderline, like they really love this game and they really love the franchise, but a lot of times when you're in the game and you know you're getting stuck on a rock or you can't vault over this or people are spawning out of nowhere, it really drives down that that fan feeling and that love that you have for a game like this. So please keep that in mind. We over here at Nation Fusion are going to score Rising Storm 2 Vietnam a 7 out of 10. It is a very good entry in the franchise. It's not the best, but it's a lot of fun to play right now, and it's competitively priced at right around $25. I can't argue with that. At $25, this is a great buy. Despite the lack of weapons, despite the lack of maps, for $24, that's $24 well spent. I definitely recommend you pick up this game if you're looking for a realistic first-person shooter set in the Vietnam War. This one is for you. It runs great. It looks great. It's a lot of fun to play. Thank you guys so much for watching. Let me know in the comments down below what you think of Rising Storm 2, and maybe we'll give away a key. We do have one key to give away, so if you leave a comment on this video, you might be the lucky winner of a Rising Storm 2 Vietnam key. Victory. Thank you for watching, and we'll see you next time on Nation Fusion TV. And in matter none.
You get a point behind Alpha while it drops a napalm there.
Foxtrot is being attacked. Recon is in the air.
Artillery coming on, Charlie.
We have taken Alpha. Armored inbound. Take cover.
Okay, let's get going.
After that strike goes out, Spot V1, could you put the mark a little bit more center on Charlie? I'm going to drop napalm.
Foxtrot is being attacked.
Perfect spot.
That's good for you?
Perfect, napalm incoming.
Hard to that.
Bravo is being attacked! Alpha is being attacked! Napalm inbound, take cover!
Danger close.
We are taking Charlie. Bravo is being attacked.
Status check shows we're all
moving, you see.
We are taking Charlie.
Napalms are called
we
out.
Have lost Alpha.
Shouldn't have gone in.